We all know that every device connected to the internet has a unique identifier called an IP address, right? But did you know that this very identifier can make you vulnerable to malicious hackers and prying eyes?
No way!
Welcome to another fantastic episode of Staying Anonymous. Because in the digital world, your security and privacy take the spotlight. By the end of this episode, we'll unravel the basics of networking, gaining an in-depth understanding of IP addresses, mastering how to stay hidden online and hack. Ethically, of course. How does an IP address work? Why do we need to shield it for online privacy and anonymity? Stick around and be sure to follow the timestamps. It's going to be a cyber awesome journey. Now let's take a quick overview. In the digital realm, unlike our human world, data and information is exchanged across networks and devices, guided by a set of protocols and procedures. These are based on the Open Systems Interconnection, OSI model or framework, and the Transmission Control Protocol Internet Protocol, TCP/IP model. The OSI model has 7 layers, and each handles a specific task of data transmission from the physical connections to the visual elements we interact with on our devices. In essence, these models define how devices should communicate. The standard protocol used for internet communication is TCP/IP, a 4-layer model based on OSI. This is just a peek into basics of networking. We'll delve deeper into this in future videos, so be sure to search more about OSI and TCP/IP and understand it more because it's going to be a key for this series. Back to our central focus. We can liken an IP address to a home where we live. Just like having a house with an address aids in linking with other services like order deliveries or accessing any shared services, an IP address serves as a unique identifier for devices or internet services on a network, enabling seamless communication between them. The string of numbers and characters you often encounter, starting with 192, 68.1.1, and various strings thereafter, is what we refer to as an IP address. Some are even in a hexadecimal format. These variations represent different versions of IP addresses. The older version, IPv4, is denoted by the familiar 192.168.1.1, while the newer version is called IPv6. This evolution arose from the limitations of IPv4, generating around 4.3 billion addresses. And in the human world, the population grows every day. Technology evolves like nobody's business. So multiple devices need IP addresses. We're gradually moving to IPv6, which allows up to approximately 340 undecillion unique addresses. That's cyber awesome, right? For the moment, just understand that IPv4 is a 32-bit version represented in decimal format, consisting of 4 numbers in octets, categorized into classes A, B, C, D, and E. That's what we're focusing on in this episode, not the IPv6. All right, let's explore the binary world when we connect to a service, like searching how to stay anonymous online. Meet our tech bro, Edward Snoobin, inspired by Edward Snowden. I call him Snoob because, well, he's a bit of a noob navigating his way into hacking and cybersecurity. Snoob's got a laptop, desktop, smart TV, smartphone, and a coffee machine, of course, all on the same Wi-Fi using a home router, his internet access point probably purchased online, maybe from Amazon. Here's what happens. Snoob's Wi-Fi gives him internet access to YouTube. Simple, right? Absolutely, that's it. But wait, some think Wi-Fi is the internet. Nope. Wi-Fi, short for Wireless Fidelity or Wireless Local Area Network, WLAN, uses radio waves to transmit data. Snoob's router, his gateway, connects his devices to the internet via Wi-Fi. Oh, by the way, the internet is a vast network connecting multiple networks globally. Let's revisit the layers and understand what really happens in the networking realms. A network, once again, is just connecting, coming together, much like the bond Snoob, our tech bro, shares with his cyber buddies through friendship, work, hacking hours, you name it. For computers, it starts with a switch, linking Snoob's gadgets, laptop, desktop, and smartphone. This switch acts as a traffic controller, connecting gadgets using MAC addresses, media access control, unique identifiers for each gadget. It's like the physical identity of each device. And in Snoob's case, it's the essence of his existence in the network. Without Snoob, his cyber buddies wouldn't be able to connect with him. Back to switches. While there are other devices like hubs that act similarly, and bridges that connect separate network segments, switches stand out. Unlike hubs, which are somewhat outdated, a switch operates at layer 2, combining the functionalities of both a hub and a bridge. It maintains a table with MAC addresses and associated ports, selectively forwarding data based on these addresses. For example, If Snoob wants to transfer data from his laptop to the desktop, the switch smartly directs it to the desktop, not the smartphone. Plus, it supports full duplex transmission, allowing efficient two-way communication. Speaking of two-way, Snoob's network, a LAN, is like a peer-to-peer setup since there are no assigned IP addresses yet. A LAN, or a local area network, covers a smaller area, like Snoob's home or a company. It's an internal or private network. To connect to other networks, devices need a vital thing, an IP address, right? And that's where a router steps in, acting as the gateway to connect to other LANs outside Snoob's network or even sub-networks within his house. Snoob might connect his smart TV and coffee machine through a router, forming subnets. Overall, the internet is a vast network, connecting multiple devices worldwide, forming LANs, PANs, personal area network, MANs, and collectively creating a WAN, wide area network, where devices communicate freely, governed by TCP/IP protocols. So when a router is connected, it assigns each device in Snoob's network a unique IP address. The devices send DHCP requests to the DHCP server, which assigns dynamic private IP addresses to each device automatically. IP addresses can also be assigned manually, and that variation is static IP addresses. Now, speaking of variations and addresses, in this case, the private IP addresses are mapped with the MAC address of Snoob's devices using the Address Resolution Protocol, ARP, and devices can only communicate internally within Snoob's LAN, so they can't connect to the internet yet. Why? Let's consider a quick scenario. Snoob, our enthusiastic tech bro, ordered a book titled Networks, Hacking, and Anonymity, and a Flipper Zero from Texas through Amazon. The items are delivered to Amazon's main store pickup point in Mumbai, where they'll confirm his payment before transferring to a delivery service for the final leg to his home, which is his private network. Here's where a public IP address comes into play. It's the one that establishes a connection to the internet and is obtained from Snoob's internet service provider by the router. The router, just like the switch, uses its routing table to identify each device by its IP addresses selectively and directs network traffic to their destinations accordingly. So whenever Snoob wants to use his laptop for the internet, the router uses network address translation, NUT, to convert the private IP into the public IP address, establishing a connection. This public IP address is more vulnerable to attacks and exposes a lot of information on the internet because it's not easily changeable. And it's typically one address for the entire network. Once again, it's due to the limited number of IP addresses, and this is what brings about all the variations of IP addresses. You can always check it by typing, "What is my IP?" on any device with internet access. So, when Snoob searches for YouTube, his favorite website, the browser sends requests to the DNS server, domain name system, to translate youtube.com into the IP address it needs. A TCP connection then steps in, playing the role of a reliable courier for data packets. The browser sends an HTTP request through the network to YouTube's server. On the server side, it identifies the specific port, port 80, responsible for establishing this digital connection. The server then dives into its database, executing backend scripts, then generates a response by returning the web page or error message for lost pages. But notice, even though our browser displays HTTPS, not HTTP, both are protocols for exchanging data on websites. Yet since YouTube and the browser value security, they employ SSL/TLS protocols for encryption. HTTP is swiftly redirected to its more secure cousin, HTTPS. And that's what most websites use. Browsers have this little lock icon signifying a secure connection. Click it and you'll unveil more security details and certificates. Insecure sites, they get flagged, ensuring your privacy. One top-tier secure browser for privacy is Brave. SSL/TLS operates in the transport layer of OSI and TCP/IP, teaming up with other major protocols like TCP and UDP. Together, they ensure data flows smoothly, reliably, and in the right format. TCP, the most precious protocol, guarantees data reaches its destination flawlessly. It's connection-oriented and uses a three-way handshake, ensuring data integrity. Snoob's laptop sends a SYN. The server responds with C and ARC. And Snoob's laptop acknowledges with an ARC connection established, ensuring Snoob always gets what he requests. TCP will always maintain the connection by reconnecting. On the flip side, we have UDP. It's connectionless, faster, and less bothered about data integrity. It cares less. Picture this. You're in class, your instructor is elaborating on TCP/IP with complex analogies, and you're nodding along, even though you might not fully grasp it because you're enthusiastic and you don't want to miss at the end of the day. That's UDP for you. Fast, but not bothered about the right order of data integrity. UDP applies more in real-time applications. Live streams, video calls, you name it. TCP, on the other hand, is the go-to for accurate data transfer, whether setting the quality to watch a YouTube video or downloading files. In our networking journey, there are vast ports and protocols like SMTP for email transfer all awaiting us. Before we delve into manipulating our IP addresses and hiding our online activities, remember this is just a glimpse into networking. Dive deeper into the OSI and TCP IP for the full picture. Now, does this episode resonate more with your enthusiasm in a TCP-like or UDP-like fashion? I bet it's a bit of both. Now let's talk about IP addresses. The public IP address exposes you to the internet. Changing it is a powerful skill, a crucial step toward anonymity in the digital realm. We're well-versed in visiting encrypted websites and using secure browsers, but there's more to the story. Ever heard of homograph spoofing? A malicious hacker can use encoded characters resembling your favorite website to trick you into revealing personal info and bank details, which they then sell on the dark web. Not forgetting man-in-the-middle attacks and other deceptions, demanding privacy and the skills to hack anonymously. The straightforward way to protect your public IP address, VPNs, proxies, and more. What about private IP addresses? They change dynamically, especially when connecting to different networks, making them safer. But they still need protection. Someone might grab Snoob's internal IP address. Connecting to a hacker's Wi-Fi or falling for DNS spoofing, real threats. Vigilance is key. Stay on top of things. Use firewalls. Turn on Windows Defender and more. Changing your private IP is a basic skill for a hacker, not just for privacy, but to hide tracks from the blue team and forensics. Remember, tech bro, it's all for ethical purposes. Now let's dive into the practical side. I'll fire up console. I'm actually running Kali Linux in a virtual machine with a GNOME desktop. Some OGs here humorously call it Kali Linux. I'll type ifconfig to check my IP address. Right there. Or you can use IP address, which kind of makes sense. IPAD, for the math geeks, or IPADR, for the programmer with a taste for weird variable names. Anyway, let's go for ifconfig. Maybe add the -a switch to display all the details. Our current IPv4 address is on the ETH0 interface, not the loopback. Changing it is easy. I'll type sudo ifconfig, specify the Ethernet interface, ETH0, then a new IPv4 address, 192.168.10.11. Enter the password, and there you have it. Changed. When we check, you'll see the difference. That's it. But hold on, we're here to learn privacy hacking skills. This is basic and won't guarantee 100% anonymity. Let's explore another method. Changing netmask and broadcast addresses. First, I'll turn down the interface with sudo ifconfig eth0 down. Confirm it's down. And now we can do sudo ifconfig eth0, our IP address, netmask. Let's use 255.255.255.128 and broadcast 192.168.10.127. I can add up to turn on the interface, or let's just hit enter and turn it back up with sudo ifconfig eth0 up. Everything is pretty cool, but I didn't just choose a random netmask. The default netmask is 255.255.255.0. For class C, adding 128 reduces the number of hosts that can share the network. The netmask determines hosts and IP addresses. Broadcast is the highest address to broadcast data packets to the hosts. Oh, hosts are devices in your network. That's it. Before ethical dosing, de-dosing, and ethical sniffing, you need some networking knowledge. We'll dive deeper in future videos. Remember, this is just one way to change IP addresses, a basic step. We should know. When you navigate to this little top right bar, then wired, connection, and wired settings, under the network, click the little icon. You'll confirm DHCP is set to automatic. So on logout or power off, it resets to a dynamically configured IP address. Even DNS is set to automatic. So how do we configure static IPs? We haven't changed the MAC address too, not forgetting VPN and proxies, Tor. To be honest, they won't guarantee full privacy online. Your system logs too, sneaking behind your back. Privacy matters though. Keep in touch, and let's explore more in this series. All right, there you have it. If you're as enthusiastic as Snoob, driven to secure, hack, and create wonders in the cyber world, be sure to like, hit the subscribe button like it owes you money, and ring the notification bell. Oh, this is a vibrant community, so I'm all circuits in the comment section. Catch you in the next episode.